We're going to get everything rolling. Thank you guys so much for showing up tonight.
Thank you for joining us this Friday evening. You know, today we've come to celebrate the life of Chris McIntire. And before I begin, I just want to say thank you for coming, especially on behalf of Noah and Delaney. I know that this means a lot. I know a lot of your faces I saw several months ago at my first drive-through visitation. And I want to say thank you to many of you that made the drive-through and then are here again this evening to remember Chris. You know, in a moment like this, with the loss of someone that a lot of us knew, a lot of us loved, he was a father, he was a son, he was a friend, he was a coworker, he was a neighbor to me. It's tempting to make today all about Chris's death. And to a certain extent, this evening is about the death of Chris. But more than that, today, what I really would love to talk about and what I would love for us to focus on is not so much that. I would love for those of us that have been impacted by Chris's life to allow this moment to point us and how to move forward and how to live our lives. So really, in many ways, I hope that this evening is all about how we're going to live. And I hope that through celebrating and remembering Chris and remembering a few stories, we are able to focus on how to properly live. Because I think each of us tonight can learn something from Chris, that will inevitably make our current life better. And I think really what I hope it does is that it points each of us to the power of knowing God through Jesus. You know, as I was talking with Noah and Delaney this past week and preparing for this moment, I heard, you know, a lot of different stories in the side of Chris I didn't know. My favorite thing that Noah said was about Chris and Noah. They would play one-on-one basketball, and up until recently, Chris could hold his own against Noah, and he said that his dad, he would make fun of his dad and trash talk him quite a bit, because his dad's only way of winning, I guess, was, I think this was the quote, old school hook shots. They're not that old, okay? They're old to you, but that he would trash talk his dad in the driveway and that Chris would just give it back to him the whole time. That's a fun memory. Delaney was telling me about her dad's laugh. These are her words, so I don't want to get in trouble. She said this, and she's allowed to. She said, his laugh was so weird. she said, like, I could hear him laugh in another room, and I knew it was him. She told me that when he would laugh, they would laugh about his laugh. And I really hope, Delaney, that you're still able to hear your dad's laughter in your head when that funny thing happens that you would laugh at together. And really, Delaney, what I hope you're able to carry forward is the joy that your dad brought to you. So together, with Noah and Delaney, and with you, I hope we can celebrate Chris's life. His old school hook shots, his weird laugh, and so much more. Christopher Jude McIntire passed away Saturday, April 4th, 2020. And I know for many of us that was a shocking moment, and none of us were prepared. He was a retired major from the Jeffersontown Police Department. He was a member of their FOP. Chris was also a member of Southeast Christian Church, and this was his church campus. He was a Marine. He was a manager for Christian Academy in the cafeteria right over there. Chris is preceded in death by his brother Joshua McIntire and survived by his mother Deborah Ramsey and his father Roger McIntire, his son Noah, and daughter Delaney. Before we go further, I'd love to read from Romans chapter 8, the end of that chapter, verses 31 through 38. It's a long section, but I think it's one that instructs us exactly how to live. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. So who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it's written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I know that came from a devotional of Chris's, one that meant a lot to him that he passed on to his mom. And she was reading that, and Debbie was reading that, and it impacted her because that section of scripture is what we all trust and hope in. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we gather here this evening, God, I pray that you open our hearts and minds to how you're gonna speak through this moment to us. God, I know in this room, there are many forms of grief represented here. God, I know for some, Chris's death is not that far ago in our hearts. And for others, we're re-engaging with something that happened months ago. But God, I pray that through this evening, through your word, God, through your presence, God, I pray that you're able to challenge each of us to understand what it means to trust you. God, what it means to trust you in life, but more importantly, God, I pray that we begin to understand what it means to trust you in our death. And so, God, I pray that this evening through the songs and through the words, that more than just remembering Chris, we're able to fix our eyes and know who you are. So, God, I pray that you connect us to you this evening. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Scattered in mercy, gathered, mended and whole, empty-handed but not forsaken. I've been set free. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see you now. I can see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down, raising up the broken to life. Take our failures and take our weakness. You set your treasure in jars of clay. So take this heart, Lord, I'll be your vessel. The world to see your life in me. Oh, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see you now. I can see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down, raising up the broken to life. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. That saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see you now. I can see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down.
I can see your love in your eyes. Good evening. My name is Tom Dillard, and I have had the honor and privilege of being the chaplain of the Jefferson Town Police Department for the last 44 years. And I am honored to be with you tonight as we share together in remembering a good friend, as well as a family member. You will find in the New Testament book of Matthew, in chapters 5, 6, and 7, the Sermon on the Mount that Jesus shares as the very essence of the gospel message with his disciples and multitudes of people who followed him. In Matthew 5, 17 through 20, Jesus says, "You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." I had the privilege of working with and sharing friendship with Chris McIntire since he began work with the Jefferson Town Police Department in 1996. And it was truly a privilege and honor for all who worked alongside him for 17 years to know and respect and appreciate what he meant to the Jefferson Town Police family and to the community. In a card sent to his family earlier this year, sincere thoughts and feelings about Chris were shared. And I would like to share a portion of that card with you tonight. Chris, he will never understand what he meant to us. He always had our respect and friendship long before he ever became our boss. We were broken when he came to us. When he became our boss, it was almost impossible the feat to pick up the pieces, but he did. God knew what we needed, and he gave us Chris. He was able over time to give each of us what we need to learn and trust and believe in a leader. He always believed in us. He was such an important part of making each of us feel whole. That alone is worth more than any of us could know. For Chris will always be remembered as a saving grace in those days. A grace only God could have delivered. We will miss this man that was such a wonderful boss, leader, friend, son, and dad. A part of Chris will live on in each of us that had the pleasure to work with and for him. How we handle stress, how we handle when we make a mistake, and especially what it means to be a loyal friend and employee. We learn so much from him, and there's not a day that goes by that we won't thank God for Chris and the blessing and impact he had in each of our lives. In so many ways, Chris's light shined brightly before so many, many people. Oh, like all of us, Chris faced his demons and battled with and through difficult trials and suffering. as we all do. However, as the words from his fellow workers remind us, Chris did echo the words of an old gospel song entitled, "Let Others See Jesus in You." And the words say, "Your life's a book before their eyes. They're reading it through and through. Say, does it point them to the skies? Do others see Jesus in you? Let others see Jesus in you. Let others see Jesus in you. Keep telling the story. Be faithful and true. Let others see Jesus in you." On behalf of the Jefferson Town Police Department family, past and present, our love and prayers go out to each and every one of you, Chris's family, and each of your friends. Our prayer is that we will stay close to one another, that we will keep up with each other, and let Christ's light shine through us every day. And I'd like to leave you with a prescription, not for the virus. I don't think we have one yet. But a prescription that you can count on, that I believe Chris counted on. And it's very simple. You may have heard it before, but it says this: count your blessings instead of your crosses. Count your gains instead of your losses. Count your joys instead of your woes. Count your friends instead of your foes. Count your smiles instead of your tears. Count your courage instead of your fears. Count your full years instead of your lean. Count your kind deeds instead of your mean. Count your health instead of your wealth. And count on God instead of yourself. Not a bad prescription to live by. And I pray God will bless you and that you will feel God's presence tonight and in all of your days from this night forward. And that your light will shine and that others will see Jesus in you as they did in Chris. I'd like to close with a police officer's prayer. Would you join me? Lord, I ask for courage. Courage to face and conquer my own fears. Courage to take me where others will not go. I ask for strength. Strength of body to protect others. And strength of spirit to lead others. I ask for dedication. Dedication to do my job and to do it well. Dedication to my community to keep it safe. Give me, Lord, concern for others who trust me and compassion for those who need me. May I be your servant during doing your work and will. And please, Lord, through it all, be at my side. O God, as your light has shined through Chris's life and through Christ our Savior, may it shine in our lives also. May your blessing, O God, be upon this McIntire family and each of these friends and co-workers. Help us to be faithful and true, letting others see Jesus in me and in you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Well, how are we supposed to follow that? I'm going to ask you to turn my mic on. We had talked about not, but I'm going to go ahead and sing. This is a song Julie, my niece, and I did at my brother's service, and I think it's appropriate.
Although we couldn't remember the key, so we're going to give it a go.
There are places I remember all my life, though some have changed, some forever, not for better. Some have gone and some remain. All these places have their moments with lovers and friends.
As I was preparing for the message for this evening, I spent a lot of time talking with Debbie, Chris's mother, and she shared so much with me. She shared about the days and weeks after Chris's death, and then more recently here in the last few months, she shared something insightful that she's learned in the time between his passing and today. And she said something like this to me. I didn't quite get the quote right, but she said, "For months, the grief of losing Chris was overwhelming. I think she used the word crippling. She said it was really difficult to process. But she said, one day I was praying and I was reading in the Bible and I read a verse. And the verse I'm going to read to you is the one she had shared with me that changed things. It comes from Philippians chapter 4. It's actually two verses, verses 6 and 7. And it goes like this. It says, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, present your requests to God." Verse 7, "And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." You know, in other words, hand your anxiety and stress and grief over to God, and he has the ability to bring peace. That sounds really easy, but we all know that grief isn't that easy to just, you know, move along. The thing I was thinking about, peace that transcends all understanding, I was thinking about when we use the word peace most often. Peace always follows a battle. You know, if you think about that, the word peace comes up at the end of the war, at the end of the battle, there's peace. There's peace when there's no more war. There's peace when it's finally come to an end. And there's peace when we finally end up giving God the thing that we are anxious about. And I think for us to really understand Chris's life, we have to understand that Chris had battles himself, that he wasn't exempt from that. And all of us in this room tonight have our own battles that look differently. The things that war over our heart, the things that we have to fight through, that no one, no matter what it looks like on the outside, no one is exempt from struggle. No one's exempt from things that break us down. So it may seem strange tonight for me to bring up a battle of Chris's, but I hope by sharing a struggle of his, that some of you may begin to find the journey to peace in your heart. Whether that struggle is something that's something known or unknown, I hope that you can face your battle head on and find the peace that only comes from God. I think as most of you know, or maybe some of you just learned, Chris really struggled with substance addiction. But I can promise you that Chris struggled nobly. He didn't give in. He fought. Chris asked for help. I met Chris about 6 or 7 years ago at the Zaxby's in Valley Station when this campus was just opening as a church. And that's when he began to share that journey with me. Chris fought bravely through the struggle. He was active in working the 12 steps, and some of you that have walked through the program, you know what that is. And I'd like to share something that Debbie had shared with me. It's an anonymous note from someone that he worked with in the 12-step program from Narcotics Anonymous. And this is the quote. "I experienced Chris's determination and his resolve, his humor and his kindness, his respectfulness and his generosity. He was devoted to his family and dedicated to his Lord and Savior. He revealed his fallibilities and his failures. He faced his humanity squarely, and he sought practical solutions to his problems. Chris was a good man. I miss his easy smile, and I miss the presence he had in my life." Guys, I think if Chris was here, he would want you to know that you shouldn't fight your battle alone. I don't know if it's addiction. I don't know what it is for you. But I think he would want everyone to know that you're never too deeply gone, that you're never too deeply broken, you're never too deeply lost to not get help, that you can fight your battle with others. And so I ask you to do what he did. Seek the wisdom of a counselor, a pastor, a church community, a friend, or a family. Do not fight the battle alone. Embrace those that are around you that have gone before you. You know, last night I was talking to Delaney on the phone, Chris's daughter, if you don't know Delaney, and we were talking for a good bit last night, and she shared something that I thought was so touching with me last night about her dad that I think speaks of Chris's character. It'd be really tempting. Chris lived in Valley Station, Delaney and the kids, in, you know, Noah live in southern Indiana. Be really tempting to be disengaged, but that's not how Chris lived. And Delaney shared, I think, one of the sweetest things that she would call her dad every evening about the time we were talking last night. I said, "What'd you talk about?" And she said, "We'd talk about our day. He would share his ups and downs, and I'd share my ups and downs. That her dad would give her advice, that Chris would give her encouragement and comfort, and that he would just be there for her." I'm sure, Delaney, you also probably heard a weird laugh right before you went to bed from him. You know, I talked to Noah a little bit earlier yesterday, and he told me that his dad's voice to him was always advice, that his dad was one that taught him how to have a job, how to live, how to have a plan. This is not going to be a shock to those of you that work closely with Chris, that how to be organized. You'll have a lot to live up to. I think Noah, this is Noah's words, not mine. He said, "Not to freestyle through life." And I think we all know that that's true on Chris. What was funny to me is that everyone that knew Chris well and worked with him knew, especially the first word, if you ask, well, who was Chris? The first word that usually comes out is organized, or maybe freakishly organized. Nothing was left unclean. I'm sorry if you had to work in the kitchen with him. I don't know what that was like. It was probably not fun, but it was clean. I'm sure all the coworkers and the police officers, I didn't know Chris during that season of his life, know that Chris was always prepared, that he didn't leave something unthought of. But the other word I kept hearing kind of in different forms as I talked to Delaney and Noah and others, Debbie, is the word that I kept popping up was this word dedicated. That Chris, all of you said that, by the way, in different ways. We talked separately, and now you guys know you all said that. That Chris was dedicated. That whatever Chris chose to do, he was going to do it full speed and fully dedicated. If he believed in it, he was going to do it nonstop, going to see it through to the end. One of the ways that Noah and Delaney shared a little bit with me and Debbie as well about this was about his kids. They competed in swimming. If you're not a swim parent, I'm going to give you a quick description. Don't be offended, guys. If you want to be hot and humid with like the chlorine filling your eyes all day for a couple minutes of enjoying your kids swimming and then hours in the chlorine and heat all day, you need to be a swim parent. But Chris didn't just go to all those meets with you. Chris became an official. So he embraced more of that because I would imagine he wanted to be near you guys and involved in what you cared about. He jumped in and got behind his kids' passion and joined them there. Chris was dedicated. He was a dedicated Marine. We heard about his dedication as a leader, as a police officer, and most recently in food service here at Cal. When you got Chris, you got someone that was fully dedicated. And many of you got the full dedication experience of Chris McIntire, good and bad. But there's another form of dedication about Chris that some of you may not know about. Years ago, at our Blankenbaker campus, the big one of Southeast Christian Church, Chris was baptized there. And Debbie and I were talking about this, and Chris and I had talked about this as well, that he struggled to feel connected to God even though he had faith. He struggled to feel a connection to who God was. It was always on his radar. And I think the battles that he faced, the addiction, I think his struggles, I think it's true for all of us that our sin-soaked eyes, the way that we look through the world, I think the Bible says it's a dim reflection. They have a way of blurring out our vision or blurring our connection to God. And I think many of us have felt this way, that maybe in this room for years have felt disconnected from God. Maybe some of you have actually lived that out and don't make any attempt to connect to God. But I can tell you, Chris tried. He tried really hard to connect and know God. You guys may think that today, October 23rd, 2020, is significant. It's not as significant. October 23rd, 2019 is significant. And there's a reason we're gathering on this date 1 year later. 1 year ago today, Chris experienced a spiritual renewal and a connection with God that he often sought. Today's the day that Chris experienced that 1 year ago. Debbie shared with me that Chris was struggling with this, and he was also at that time deep in his struggle with his 12 steps. He was desperately trying to work through. And specifically to those of you that are familiar with that, I think he was on step 3, which is about the higher power, the power of God. He would say to Debbie, his mom, he would say that he doesn't know what to say to God or how to have a conversation with God. And Debbie would say what Debbie would say, which is just start talking. And he says, I can't do that. He's God. On October 23rd, 2019, a year ago today, Chris wasn't planning on having a moment, but he had a moment where he finally decided to talk to God, and he poured out his heart to God 1 year ago today. Now, this is going to be a moment of too much information, but Chris isn't here to stop us, so we're going to do it. And Debbie told me to, so, you know. He referred to it as his bathtub conversion because he was taking a bath, and in that moment is when he finally decided to start experiencing God and praying. And he said it was kind of unexpected that he began to share his burdens with God. And she said, Debbie was telling me, from that day forward, he was a different person. He became visibly different, that the anxieties and stresses from that he was carrying were lifted, that he was definitely a different person. So today, I think we can celebrate 1 year later, knowing that Jesus, to Chris, was more than someone he wanted to know, but someone he knew as Savior and Lord, and that Jesus was someone he wanted to know, but someone he also trusted. Many of you knew that in March, very early in the pandemic, and probably the first person most of us knew, I was texting this with you, that contracted COVID was Debbie. It was the first person I knew when it became real a little bit around here for me. I asked her, I said, were you tested positive? And she said, this was before there was testing. It was that early. So we assumed it was because all the symptoms matched. So she was expecting to be admitted to the hospital one night, couldn't breathe very well, and was fully expecting that she was going to be spending the night and had obviously let Chris know she couldn't catch her breath. Debbie then shared with me, and some of you may know the story, that her symptoms lifted suddenly out of nowhere. They didn't really have an explanation, but she could breathe. And so they sent her home. And when Debbie was relaying this to Chris, he said, well, that doesn't surprise me. We've been praying for you. What'd you expect? Chris had actually also notified the women's ministry here at Southwest, where she's involved, and they began praying. This wasn't normal for Chris to call the women's ministry up to begin to pray for his mom, okay? This wasn't a normal thing. I know Chris well enough. It's not his thing. And it's just one example, an easy example to see how Chris had allowed God to begin to become a part of his everyday life, that he allowed Jesus to empower how he lived. You know, in many ways, I know, Delaney, we were talking about this last night, that it feels like for Chris, his story was mid-sentence while we were writing in the middle of a chapter and the pen just stopped writing. I know a lot of us wish the story would have been written differently, don't we? We wish there were more chapters. I wish there were more chapters for you guys. We may be sad, and I know family and friends here may be sad as well. I think some of us are even sad in this season for a lot of different reasons beyond Chris that have to connect to our personal battles, the things that we carry in our heart. But I guess what I want you to know as I close this evening is that this, you are not without hope. That Chris, in the depth of his struggle, was not without hope. That all of us can reach out to God through Jesus and know him and experience that. And for those that want to know God, he's available to know you. And when you know God, that truth that Debbie shared from Philippians chapter 4, verse 7, the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. That peace that comes from the battle ending is available to all. And I think Chris would want you to know that. Let's pray. God, thank you for this evening. God, thank you for a chance for us all to pause and reflect on Chris's life. God, I pray that we do not leave these moments without one of two things, either reaffirming what we believe without reaffirming that we trust in you and know that peace, or God, that we can begin to question you about that and seek you. God, I pray for those that are here that are battling alone, that they will get help, that they will not feel trapped, but God, they will know that you are available to them and it is found in your church. And so God, I pray that those that find themselves in situations that Chris has faced, he would want you to know that you save. And so God, I pray for that. God, I pray especially for Noah and Delaney tonight. God, I pray they pick the pen up and they begin writing the chapters of how they're going to remember and live out the legacy of their father. God, I pray that they continue in what he left behind. Not just in who he was, not just in what he did, but God, in who he trusted. And so I pray that blessing upon Delaney. I pray that blessing upon Noah, that they can walk in courage and know you. And know that when they do that, they're honoring their dad. So God, be with all of us this evening as we close. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Music. upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you. The Lord.